All right, Raider Nation, welcome back into the Fan Cave for another RFR conversation. Your old buddy Murph here with my cousin Sonny. And welcome in Associated Press writer and often Raider commentator, the one and only, the Twitter legend, Josh DeBow.
Yeah, no problem. How are you guys?
Doing fantastic, Josh. Appreciate you joining us here in the Fan Cave, man. It's great to have you in. And, you know, of course, we're all excited that it's football season, man. And that's got to be music to your ears, too, that now we're back in the season and you actually got something that you can keep up with and write about, no?
Yeah, no, it's a lot better to be talking about games and stuff as opposed to going through all the other stuff that we went through in the offseason.
Yeah.
Much more interesting.
There you go. So, hey, so before we jump in the Raider talk, tell us a little bit about you. How did you get your start? How did you get hooked up with the AP and writing about the Raiders and all that good stuff?
I started in college, University of Michigan, writing for the student paper there, and then did some freelance stuff for AP while I was there, and started work with AP right out of college in New York, and moved out here in 2004 and started covering the Raiders in 2005. So it's been season number 16.
16. So you've seen, you've kind of been around. We had a couple blips on the radar there of good play, but other than that, 2005.
Yeah,
2005 to now.
It's
been a rough run for you covering the Raiders, hasn't it?
Yes. So it explains maybe why some of the tweets are a little negative. I haven't seen them.
So, Josh, are you a hater?
I'm not a hater. I just, I get accused of it, but I don't consider myself a hater. But there is a lot more. Look, I'm happy to point out anything. I like to point out the interesting stats. So when a team loses as much as it does, the stats are more negative. But I actually did, because why not during this time of quarantine when we have time to do whatever? I actually just looked back at my tweets from November this past year when the Raiders won 3 games in a row. I was like, wow, there are a lot of positive stats in here. So, team starts winning, the stats become much more positive.
So, Josh, can numbers lie?
Sure. Yeah.
How so?
Well, this could be a sensitive topic for some, but if you want to look at, like, Derek Carr, I think has the highest passer rating in Raider history. Does that make him the greatest quarterback in Raider history? No, I'd say Ken Stabler is the greatest quarterback in Raider history.
Right on.
So, you can use numbers in different ways. There's definitely, it's how you use them. You can use them to paint the story. And I think I tried to do it accurately. I think, some people would obviously disagree with that, but I happen to think Ken Stabler is better than Derek Carr. Some people don't agree with that, but there you go.
I'm 100% with you on that. And if you look at Kenny Stabler's stats, they're awful. You know?
The interception. So, yeah, it's a totally different era when they're playing back then, when your guys are throwing basically one touchdown for every interception, pretty close to it. And now, things have totally changed. I think people sometimes look at the raw stats and completion percentage and yards and rating and things like that and don't recognize that the game is totally different. The rules have changed, the approach has changed, and to be a good quarterback now, you got to put up a lot better numbers than you did 20 years ago.
Derek Carr, is he the Raiders quarterback of the future or not? And do you allow him this year to prove himself? Like, that's kind of the mantra everybody's saying is, now we have the receivers, so this is his year to prove it or not. Does he get another pass, or is this it for him, do you think?
I think it would be really, if we're looking at another season where they don't score 20 points a game, don't have a winning record, don't make the playoffs, like, I think it's hard to just keep making excuses at that point. But, I think if they perform the way they think they can perform this year, could he be the quarterback going down the line? Sure. But I think they have to perform better than they have the last 3 years if you want to, stick with the same direction that you've been going.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, and certainly he's better supported than he always has been, not always, but he's better supported than he has been recently.
Than he was the last couple of years.
Absolutely, yes. Mm-hmm. So you spoke to the numbers, and you spoke about Kenny Stabler. Kenny Stabler was an MVP of the league, and he threw for 2,500 yards. I mean, Kenny didn't have those big numbers. I've kind of had the opinion this season, and I know it kind of runs against a little bit of what the NFL goes, the direction the NFL is going in with these high-powered offenses. But I felt like if it's not all dependent on Derek, if Derek only has to throw for 200, 250 yards a game, throw a couple touchdown passes and let the defense and Josh Jacobs do the work, isn't that when he's at his best, or am I misreading that as a fan?
I guess the question, do you think that this is a defense that's good enough for that kind of approach is the question. And giving up 30 points to Carolina, isn't great evidence of that? obviously it's one game, it's early, yeah. they can play better, but I think, can you win with average to above, slightly above average quarterback play and not Patrick Mahomes? Sure, but then you need the 49ers defense last year. Mm-hmm. and the 49ers running game last year. And then you can you win with, you know, Jimmy, they were a few minutes away from winning a Super Bowl with Jimmy Garoppolo, who's, you know, basically the same level of quarterback as Derek Carr. Some people pick one, some people pick the other, but they're basically, you know, they're in that group of guys who are basically, you know, that average, slightly above average, slightly below average, depending on the year, quarterback. So
what do you say to the, I see on, I'm sorry, go, please.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Well, I see on Twitter all the time. I mean, and I've been following you for a long, long time, even before this, you know, you, of course, you got a lot of attention here lately, but even, but long before that, I've been following you because this, and I do your numbers on our show all the time. And I always give you credit. I'm like, this, here's some numbers and here's some like just little factoids and things that I pull during the course of the week that you're sending out there. And the information is phenomenal. And so, and I really trust where you're coming from. And so I got, really, I got two questions for you. So first, let me ask you, what's the source of your, do you have a database you're pulling from that the AP provides you? Or are you Google searching this stuff? Like, how do you come up with all these wonderful stats you do?
Well, we've got AP's got a contract with Sport Radar. And Sport Radar has the official NFL stats. So they have a database that you can search through, which is where, you know, a lot of this stuff comes from. And some of it comes from, you know, Pro Football Reference. It's a great resource. It's available to anyone. A lot of the stuff you can get from there. And then Football Outsiders, Pro Football Focus occasionally, Sports Info Solutions, various different places. But say Sport Radar is probably the main one. And just for the historical kind of things. And then, yeah, there's a little bit of Pro Football Reference. Sometimes it's easier to use that one.
So when you put these things out there, and again, they're awesome. And I encourage people all the time. I'm like, go follow Josh. Like, go follow him on Twitter. If you're a Raider fan, like, and you want it raw and you want to know what it is, then, and it's funny because you put these things out there and people take them and like as opinion or like, or with agenda, but you're not doing that. And I think that it's up to each own to interpret however they want to, but oftentimes it's like people get defensive. Right. And so I see people come at you and they're like, well, yeah, but Derek doesn't have receivers. Well, yeah, but he doesn't have a defense. Well, yeah, but he doesn't. So my question to you then is this: what does a defense need to look like numbers wise to then squelch that argument to where Derek does have a defense or the Raiders offensively have a defense to complement?
I think it depends what you're arguing. If you're arguing why they're scoring 18, 19 points a game, then I think putting the blame on the defense, you know, that's a little tough, right? The offense to be able to score, you know, when Drew Brees had bad defenses in New Orleans, they scored 25, 26, 27 points a game. You should be able to score, you know, does it help if you get more turnovers and get better field position? Sure, it helps. But you shouldn't be at the bottom of the league if you're an elite quarterback, no matter what your defense is. In terms of winning, you're going to need a good defense. You're going to need at least probably an average defense. You know, that's basically what Kansas City had last year. It was, you know, somewhere around an average defense. If you have that and you have a great offense, you can win. If you don't have a great offense, then you're going to probably need an elite defense. So just, you know, it's just a sliding scale. You can be, you know, I think offense is easy. I think offense is, it's easier to stay good on offense year in, year out. I think there are teams, you look at the teams that have had success, it's been that have had consistent success over lots of years. It's been the ones who've had the quarterbacks. Like, that's how it is. The offense you can sustain, and the quarterback is so far and away the most important part of the offense. If you have the quarterback, that you just have a floor, you know, you could Seattle, like, even in their worst seasons, when they doesn't have talent them on offense and the defense isn't as good, you're still looking, okay, they're going to be 9-17 because Russell Wilson's really good. And if he's got the Legion of Boom and Marshawn Lynch running it, now they're a Super Bowl contender. Yeah, so I think you're just looking at that. The offense is easier to sustain. The defense, you know, you look at Jacksonville, you can have one year with a great defense, but you have Blake Bortles at quarterback. That's not going to be – that's not sustainable. The Bears with Trubisky, you know, you see teams
– or Rex Grossman. So,
right, yeah, with the Rex Grossman Bears. It's basically right, where it's like, okay, they had a year where, yeah, they were really good, and then it's like, okay, why don't you? Because it's so hard with defense because it's hard to keep the 11 guys. It's easier for the opposing offense to pick on the weak link. So if you're not really good at every level of defense, then the other team can sort of still find something to exploit. Guys get hurt. Guys get new contracts, and you lose them. It's just hard to sustain on defense. It's much easier to sustain on offense. If you have a great quarterback, now you're ahead of the game. Like, the Chiefs is only so bad the Chiefs are going to be as long as Patrick Mahomes is healthy. They're not going to be a 4-win team with Patrick Mahomes. They can have injuries. They can have a bad defense, whatever. They're still going to be scoring 24, 25 points a game, and they're going to be competitive.
Josh, do you feel that Derek Carr was trending in that direction prior to 2016 and the injury. And ever since then, he's just hasn't been the same old self. Because at one point, it seemed like he was moving there, and now he's just fallen off to be this average quarterback. What happened there, you think?
Yeah, I don't know. He definitely played better. He definitely took more chances, it seemed like. He threw the ball deeper in 2015. And even 2017, when it didn't go well, he actually threw the ball deeper. It wasn't successful that year. And he's definitely not done that. And I think, you know, people make a big deal. Okay, Drew Brees doesn't throw the ball deep and they win. And it's sure, you can throw the ball short and win. The 49ers offense is built that way. The Saints offense is built that way. But it's easier when you're throwing the ball, you know, Al Davis knew that year. Like, it is, you know, it is easier in big chunk plays on offense to get, you know, to score. When you're trying to move the, you know, the John Gruden offense a little bit, when you're doing those 4 or 5 yards at a time and get the third and manageable and convert the third down, then it's basically one holding penalty or one sack. And it's like, okay, our drive is stalled. Whereas if you're Patrick Mahomes and it's third and 18, it's like, okay, fine. I'll complete a 30-yard pass on third and 18 and then we'll go, you know? So I think he has become a little more, whether it's him or whether it's the Gruden offense or whatever it is, he's definitely become less willing to throw the ball deep. He did a couple times the first half last week, which was encouraging. He had three, I think, in the first half, which was a good sign.
That one to Ruggs early on, even though he didn't connect on him,
Even when you don't connect, even when you don't connect on him, they still have an effect, you know. And then he hits one to Ruggs, he hits one to Aguilar, and you know, had another, I think, one to Ruggs. There's maybe 18 yards downfield. So you know, definitely when you do that, you don't have to do it 20 times a game. You know, you do it 4 or 5 times a game, and that's sometimes enough. You know, you know, maybe you hit one or two of them and that gives you a score or a scoring drive, you know, leads to a scoring drive, or maybe you now loosen things up. So now when you dump it off to the running back, it's a 12-yard gain instead of a 6-yard gain. And now it's a favor in the chains, things like that.
So is that more on Gruden for the offense or is that more on Carr for not taking it deep?
That's hard to tell. Gruden's offense is definitely more, has always been more suited in the West Coast, the traditional West Coast and the shorter stuff. You know, I think he would like Carr to take more chances. You know, he won't come out and say it, but so I think it's hard to totally tell unless you're in the meeting rooms with those guys. When there were opportunities for Derek maybe to throw deep when he hasn't. So it's hard as an outsider to say who that's on. But I think that's, you know, it's probably a combination, you know, like most things, it's a little bit of both. But I think, you know, I think for this offense to reach the levels that, you know, they need to reach, that they want to reach, they need to take a little more chances. And that's why they drafted Ruggs. You know, Gruden wanted Ruggs, Mayock wanted, you know, they wanted, I think, you know, they definitely recognized it. They got a guy who they think they can stretch the field a little bit and help him get these big plays. So we'll see if it lasts.
Do you think there was any reason Edwards didn't see a lot of action?
I don't know. It was kind of curious. I will say this. I haven't been out at training camp because I'm still back in the Bay Area. I'll be going in for the game this week. So I had not seen them practice. So I'm just going by, you know, what I was, and the reports from all the guys who were at practice is, man, Edwards is really.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, yeah. Like everything you're reading. Now, Gruden would always try to downplay that anytime anyone brought it up. So maybe there were other things going on, but he was on the field a lot. So they obviously trust him. I think maybe it was just circumstance that he didn't get the ball to beat, but you know, we'll see this week whether he's a little more involved, but I was expecting more.
Yeah. You know, we all were
more than one target.
Hey Josh, we couldn't bring you on a Raider show without bringing up the non-answer that was heard around the world.
I've seen that a few times in my Twitter mentions.
I'm sure you had a blocking party after this.
I have not blocked anyone who tweets it. I keep seeing it.
Good job.
I'm not big on the block. So
okay. Good job, man. Love it, man. Yeah.
What's that like being a reporter, asking the kind of the tough questions and getting that kind of answer and then seeing that kind of trend and go viral? And like, do you sit there and go, I shouldn't ask it, or is that good for you? Or take us through that process as a writer for you.
Well, it's not that unusual. I think the more unusual part is now that these are all broadcast on Zoom and can see them. You know, it's not the first time that I've asked a question and someone hasn't wanted to answer it and answered, you know, basically said, I'm not answering it kind of situation like that. But when it's in a locker room and it's not on Zoom for everyone to see it and can, you know, put it up on Twitter and social media, you know, it just dies that day. You know, you ask the question, it's over and we move on. So, but it doesn't matter. Right? He doesn't want to answer the question. He doesn't have to answer the question. I thought it was a legitimate question. If people are amused by the answer, right? That's fine. That doesn't bother me. You know, I can just ignore the every time that I see it in my Twitter mentions after every, you know. But
I mean, it's probably gotten you some street cred a little bit, you know, with certain Raider fans. So,
yeah, there are definitely some who appreciate it, and definitely some who don't. So,
well, we've already seen it just doesn't matter, Josh, on T-shirts, and we've seen.
Oh wow!
Yeah,
I've not seen the T-shirts.
So. Oh yeah, and it's a meme already. Like people are using that. It's the body language that was demonstrated there that followed along with it is what sold it, I think. But yeah, but that was but yes, I thought a very fair question as well. So I got two more for you, then we'll let you get out of here. And first off, thank you for your time. Thank you for spending a few minutes with us here at Raiders Fan Radio. So you mentioned you're gonna be in Vegas. Do you get to attend the game?
Yes.
Okay, cool. All right. So you'll actually get a chance to see Allegiant. What are your expectations about that?
I'm excited for it. The pictures I've seen look amazing. The people I know who've been in, you know, I love the Coliseum. So
Well, us too. We grew up in the Bay Area too. So we know where you're coming from.
I cover the 49ers and the Raiders, and I always find it more enjoyable to cover a game at the Coliseum. I think our seat was better in the press box. You could hear the fans. Like in modern stadiums, the press boxes are all sealed shut. You can't even hear the fans. And the Coliseum was 10 minutes from my house, so convenient. I loved it, but I am looking forward to seeing Allegiant. It should be pretty cool.
Good deal, man. So hey, we're broadcasted down there. We're some of the crew here in the fan cave. We're headed down to the game as well. Of course, we won't get to go to the game, but we're running to you at the Stage Door Casino or something. The beverages are on me, my friend.
There you go,
Sonny. You got anything else for Josh before we let him get out of here?
How big is Vic Taffer in person?
Picture Trent Brown and go up like a size or two. Like Trent Brown
seen Trent Brown, so I can't.
Nice. Good one, Sonny. There you go. Well, Josh DuBow, it's Josh DuBow AP, correct? That's your Twitter handle. Yep. Raider Nation, if you're not following him, you're doing it wrong. Follow Josh on Twitter. Anything else, Josh, that you can promote or shout out or anything while we got you?
No, all good. So good being with you guys. So enjoy the first game.
All right, man.
Cool.
First game at home. Appreciate you, Josh.
All right, brother.
Talk to you
guys. Appreciate you.
Bye.
Take care.
Bye.